It was a dynasty unparalleled in the history of American hockey. A team created in 1972 had, in a little more than a decade, captured four consecutive Stanley Cups. The New York Islanders are a truly remarkable organization, ranking with the New York Yankees, the Boston Celtics, and the Green Bay Packers among the great teams of all time. From 1980 to 1983, the Islanders became the first American-based hockey team to string together four consecutive Stanley Cups. In doing so, men like Denny Potvin, Mike Bossy, Brian Trottier, Billy Smith, and their teammates created, matched, and broke record after record. Record-breaking was part of the Islander tradition right from the start, although the early records were woeful rather than triumphant. The amazing nature of the Islanders' rise can only be measured in contrast to the adversity they suffered through in their early years. The team was yet another branch on the National Hockey League's expansion tree. It started in 1966 when the league decided to double its size. In 1967, the original six teams were joined by new franchises in Philadelphia, Los Angeles, Pittsburgh, Minnesota, Oakland, and St. Louis. Then in 1970, Buffalo and Vancouver became NHL cities. And it was in 1972 that two more teams came into the fold, the Atlanta Flames and the original New York Islanders. For the first time in three decades, the New York area had two NHL franchises. Starting with their first season in the National Hockey League with general manager Bill Torrey at the helm, the club faced a situation unique to the sport. For the first time, a rival major league had emerged. Before the Islanders ever took to the ice, some of their very best prospects were kidnapped by the budding World Hockey Association. Between the rating of the WHA and the skimpy offerings of the expansion draft, the Islanders had precious little to choose from.
We weren't really very much concerned about those players because they were all cast-offs. They were players that either weren't good enough or had created problems for other teams. That's why they were available in the first place. So we were not really very, very concerned about them on a long-term basis. So actually losing them was a benefit, not a, in any way a negative. Short-term, yes, it hurt us the first year, but all we did then was just create an opportunity for younger players to get an opportunity to play a little bit quicker.
The core of the club would be veterans from the expansion draft. Ed Westfall, an 11-year veteran who played on two Stanley Cup winning teams with the Boston Bruins, goalies Jerry Desjardins and Bill Smith, defenseman Jerry Hart, and forwards Don Blackburn and Terry Crisp. In the amateur draft, their number one pick was young Billy Harris, followed by a youngster named Lorne Henning. Also coming in that first draft were two men who would play a big role in the club's later success, a strapping right wing named Bob Nystrom and a spunky left winger named Gary Howitt. But only Harris would start with the parent club that first season. Bill Torrey's coaching choice was 38-year-old Phil Goyette, a slick forward who had played with three cup-winning Montreal Canadiens teams, as well as with the New York Rangers, the St. Louis Blues, and the Buffalo Sabres, where he coached but one NHL game. On opening night at the brand new Nassau Veterans Memorial Coliseum, a crowd of 12,221 watched Eddie Westfall score the Islanders' first NHL goal. It was a battle of the NHL's worst teams, but the crowd enjoyed it, despite a late goal by Bob Leiter, which gave Atlanta the win. But it didn't take long for the Islanders to notch their first win at the Coliseum, as 4 days later, they hosted the Los Angeles Kings. The game featured the debut of battling Billy Smith in goal and an unsuccessful penalty shot by rookie Billy Harris. Finally, with only 69 seconds remaining, left wing Germain Gagnon fired the puck past Kings goalie Rogge Vachon, and the Islanders won 3-2 for their first NHL victory. Unfortunately, the euphoria of that victory was short-lived, as the Islanders soon gained a firm hold on the NHL basement. Still, there were a few bright spots, not the least of which being a 9-7 victory over the tough Boston Bruins at the Boston Garden.
Well, I guess for about 3 or 4 months, every city we went into, that was the word that we saw in big, bold print. Here come the hapless Islanders. And, You know, it's like anything else. After you hear it or see it long enough, you get a little tired of hearing it. But it kind of became a tag for us that first year. But like our whole program that year was not so much how many we were going to win, but it was to get as many of the younger players involved and get them started as we possibly could. We were in the toughest division. There were only two divisions then, and we weren't going to win. We had no anticipation of winning, and the amateur draft rather than the expansion draft was the key to our whole program.
Getting up for hockey games, 1972, it was not hard to get up for the games. The challenge was really the thing. We had a lot of players that probably would never have had an opportunity to play in the National Hockey League had it not been for the Islanders taking them in the draft. You have to remember that 11 of the players drafted by the Islanders that year jumped to the World Hockey, as well as a lot of other players from the National Hockey League. And the players that remained and made the team, they were desperate to keep their jobs, and they worked very hard. So getting up for the games and the challenges within the games wasn't really that difficult. It was difficult, though, when you saw the players working as hard as they did and not having too many results. A lot of these players were players that come from teams in the American Hockey League and other places, junior teams, where they may have had some success on their own, but they weren't seeing any of it with the Islanders.
It was inevitable that there would be casualties that first year, off the ice as well as on. The first victim was coach Phil Goyette, who was replaced in January by interim coach Earl Ingerfield. Ingerfield did his best to rally the club, but their first season was marked by a number of negative records, including their mark of 12 wins, 60 losses, and 12 ties, which set a new NHL record for futility. But Bill Torrey remained undaunted. Although general managers such as Montreal's Sam Pollock made attractive offers, Torrey would not give up his early draft choices.
It's only natural that since the use of the amateur draft as we know it, or the entry draft as we now call it, obviously the teams that are at the top have the highest number of points. They're the ones that draft lowest. So, and they supposedly, with expansion teams, tried to help expansion teams by giving them excess players. But as I said at the very beginning, we knew that the years of 73, 74, 75 were all abundant years. They had good crops of amateur players coming, and that was the basis for our development. And I can remember walking around the Mount Royal Hotel about four or five times, and every time we circled the block, Sam offered me a couple of more players. But Emil Francis, the Rangers, there were a number of teams that made very, very attractive offers. That just really was not in our program.
Despite enormous pressure, Torrey refused to yield his first-round draft pick in the person of young defenseman Denny Potvin.
Well, I think much like the Islanders, I didn't know very much about the National Hockey League when I came to New York. I didn't know much about New York itself. To me, it was a city that I'd seen in the movies, and it was a long way from Ottawa, where I came from. So I didn't come here with any kind of anticipation of being overwhelmed by a city, but I did come with some real goals that I had set, and that was to, first of all, try and be part of a team that could be built into a contender and to establish myself as a defenseman in the National Hockey League. I don't think I looked at it as outside pressure, because I was putting enough pressure on myself to satisfy that end of it.
After drafting Potvin, Torrey made the most significant move of his managerial career when he signed former NHL defenseman Al Arbour to coach the club.
I wasn't really interested in coming to the island. Bill Torrey approached me in Montreal, and I told him to forget it, really. And then I thought, really, the island was like New York City, because I'd played in the city all the time, Madison Square Garden, and I had four children, and I wasn't about to bring the family to that environment. And about a month later, we were in Florida. The wife and I were discussing things, and she didn't want to go to the one place that I was headed for. So I called Bill Torrey back, and I asked him if the job was open. He said yes. He invited me down here. I come down to visit the island and talk to Bill, and that's how it all started.
Despite the new regime, the initial results did not bode well. The team posted a record of 3 losses and 4 ties in their first 7 games. Then they met their arch rivals, the New York Rangers, at the Nassau Coliseum. And incredibly, they won. Although the club once again finished in the basement of 1973-74, there had been major improvements in all areas, and the rapidly maturing Denny Potvin set rookie defenseman scoring records, as well as winning the Calder Cup as Rookie of the Year. Nobody knew it then, but the 73-74 season would be the last time the New York Islanders would miss the playoffs. The event which would catapult the Islanders into their first playoff berth was the 1974 amateur draft. The team's number one pick was a 6'3", 215-pound left wing from Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan, named Clark Gillies. Also, goalie Jerry Desjardins defected to the WHA, giving 25-year-old goalie Glenn Resch a strong chance of making the club. As the 1974-75 season began, there were definite signs that the Islanders were gelling as a competitor, one of which was the emergence of center Bob Bourne, a slick, fast center who scored his first NHL goal in the third game of the season. When Billy Smith flanked the Washington Capitals, the Islanders had their first shutout in club history after 161 NHL games, and young Denny Potvin scored his first NHL hat trick. In a 10-0 drubbing of the Oakland Seals, veterans Eddie Westfall and Billy McMillan each scored a hat trick, and the club set records for goals and shots in a game. Remarkably, at the end of October, the team had 10 wins and only 1 loss. They were sitting at the top of the NHL. The bubble finally burst when the club went on a 5-game road trip and dropped 5 straight. Halfway through the season, their record stood at 16 wins, 15 losses, and 9 ties, and they were sliding. Bill Torrey knew that a key element was missing. The club needed some veteran firepower to complement his eager, but still erratic youngsters. Within 3 days in January of 1975, Torrey engineered 2 deals with the Minnesota North Stars that would have a major effect on the club, as J.P. Parisi and Jude Drouin became Islanders. Between shouts of J.P., J.P., and boisterous renditions of the Beatles' classic, Hey Jude, the club got its act together and launched a home stretch drive.
It's very important to, when you're developing a club, to have the right atmosphere so the players could develop. And we needed players like Drouin, Parisi, with NHL experience. They'd been through the league and they'd played a number of years and they were very solid hockey players. And they were the type of players that would help develop our kids, along with the other veterans that we had on our team, and would create great leadership on the ice, the games, the way they played, and in crucial situations, how they would respond, and the pressure never bothered them. And, you know, it's for our kids to really learn through their leadership on the ice, and it was very important, and they did that for us.
With only 5 games remaining in the season, Glenn Resch won against the Rangers at home, and the Islanders moved into second place in their division. But they tied their next 2 games against Atlanta, and it was only when the Flames were beaten by the Rangers that the Islanders clinched a playoff berth for the first time. Both the Islanders and the Rangers ended up with 88 points, but with more wins, the Rangers got the home ice advantage in the best of 3 series. What began as a milestone by simply making the playoffs was about to become a series of stunning and unbelievable upsets. In the first game against the Rangers at hostile Madison Square Garden, the Islanders trailed by 2, but rallied in the third period to tie the game. Then, at 13:30 of that third period, Clark Gillies drove home the winning goal and sent the Rangers crashing to defeat. But the Rangers bounced back in game 2, setting the stage for the third and deciding game at Madison Square Garden. It was the new boys on the team, Drouin and Parisi, who won the series in overtime when Parisi took a pass from Drouin and drove home the winning tally.
At the start of the overtime period, Drew Drouin got the faceoff to Dave Lewis, who just skated past the red line, dumped it in. Jude went in the corner, and for some reason, the New York Ranger player didn't get the puck, so Jude just went out, skated, got the puck, and I happened to be skating in front of the net. The puck was on my stick, and I scored the winning goal. Just a wonderful feeling.
Next, the Islanders would face a foe loaded with firepower, the Pittsburgh Penguins. From the start, the Islanders looked out of their league when Pittsburgh took the first three games in the best of seven series. But Coach Al Arbour had developed the never-say-die spirit in his club. Still, it would be a difficult task. In all of professional sports, there was a single precedent in which a club came back from a 3-0 deficit in game. It was in 1942 that the Toronto Maple Leafs came back from the 3-0 brink to take four straight from the Detroit Red Wings and win the Stanley Cup. Slowly but relentlessly, the Islanders began their comeback, starting with a power play goal by Andre Saillant at 3:45 of the first period in Game 4. This was the first time the Islanders had made the initial tally in the series. The Islanders then went on to take Games 4, 5, and 6 to set up the decisive seventh game. If the final match of the Rangers-Islanders series had been a spine tingler, the seventh game with Pittsburgh was even more thrilling. For more than 2.5 periods, both goalies stopped every shot hurled at them. Then, at 14:35 of the third period, the Islanders organized an attack, and Eddie Westfall drove home the first goal of the game. Afterwards, goalie Glenn Resch became an immovable object, and the Islanders held on to take the game and the series.
We got behind three games against the Pittsburgh Penguins, and the team felt we had them exactly where we wanted them. But seriously, I can remember going back on the island at the practice rink, and Al got us together, and he said, "Boys, if anyone of you guys doesn't feel that you can beat this team, just take your stuff off and go home. We won't need you. We'll just go on because we feel that we have a better team than they have, and we're going to win this thing."
Suddenly, this mix of youth and experience found itself face to face with the defending champions, the notorious Broad Street Bullies, otherwise known as the Philadelphia Flyers. Once again, the Islanders got themselves behind the eight ball, losing three straight and facing elimination in the Nassau Coliseum. Riding the crest of a 21-game unbeaten streak, the Flyers were ready to wrap up the series in four straight. But Coach Al Arbour rallied his skaters, and incredibly, they reeled off three consecutive wins, and again it came down to a seventh game. This time, however, there would be no repeat of the 1942 Maple Leafs. Flyers' Gary Dornhofer scored at 19 seconds of the first period, and the Flyers went on to win the game 4-1, taking the series and eventually the Stanley Cup. Still, it had been a glorious year for the young Islander franchise. After being basement dwellers their first two seasons, the Islanders were now nicknamed the Cinderella Team of the National Hockey League. With the new season beginning, Bill Torrey concentrated in strengthening the club at center ice. In 1974, he had drafted an underage youngster from Saskatchewan, but kept him in junior hockey for another year. Then, when the 1975-76 season began, Torrey and Arbour unveiled the new young centerman, Brian Trottier. His first game at the Nassau Coliseum offered a portent of things to come as he scored his first NHL hat trick. Trottier's debut was hardly a fluke. Centering for Billy Harris and Clark Gillies, he soon flowered into a bona fide superstar. The 1975-76 season became the year of Brian Trottier as he broke all existing rookie scoring records and won the Calder Cup as Rookie of the Year. The team finished the regular season second in the Patrick Division behind the Flyers and possessed the best penalty-killing combination in the league. When the playoffs started, the Islanders swept Vancouver, stumbled against Buffalo, then recovered and beat the Sabres in six games. Then they ran headlong into a Montreal Canadiens team that was on its way to winning four straight Stanley Cups. The Islanders took one game, but lost the series 4-1. During the 1976-77 season, the Islanders began to hear whispers of also-ran and always a bridesmaid, never a bride. Again, they finished second behind the front-running Philadelphia Flyers. And after sweeping Chicago and Buffalo in their first two playoff rounds, they again ran into an unstoppable Montreal club and yielded 4-2. It was another disappointing end. The club needed a last piece, and this final piece of the puzzle had to be a sharpshooter of the highest magnitude. Mike Bossy arrived on Long Island with little fuss or fanfare, but it took him no time at all to make his mark in the NHL. Now, for the first time in the brief history of the franchise, there was talk that the Islanders could be a serious Stanley Cup contender. They had the best goaltending combination in the league, an all-star defense, superior specialty squads, and now Mike Bossy had given them the added dimension of a top-flight gunner. But the first of two crushing disappointments which shook the character of the team was about to follow. During the 1978 playoffs, the Islanders were extended through a brutal seven-game series with Toronto, only to lose when Lanny McDonald scored a breakaway goal against Chico Resch in sudden-death overtime of the final game. The second crusher came the following year, after the club had put together their best regular season record of 51 wins, 15 losses, and 14 ties. What's more, Denny Potvin received his third Norris Trophy as best defenseman. Trottier scored 134 points to capture the heart, and the club compiled the best penalty-killing record in the league. But matched against their cross-city rivals, the Rangers, in the playoffs, the Islanders were stymied by the outstanding goaltending of John Davidson and the hard-checking Ranger team, a team that eventually would make the Stanley Cup Finals. General manager Bill Torrey was still in the process of building the club and kept adding players to supplement the lineup. On defense were Stefan Persson, Gord Lane, and Dave Langevin. And at left wing, he acquired the hard-nosed, hard-driving John Tinelli from the WHA. In a trade with Cleveland, he picked up a strong defensive center in Wayne Merrick. Each of these players would play a major role in the remarkable 1979-80 season, a campaign which did not start out well. While the world watched the United States Olympic hockey team win a gold medal in February 1980, the Islanders were 6-6-1 for the month and seemed mired in the middle of the NHL pack. But on March 1st, Denny Potvin returned to the lineup from an extensive injury, and Olympic defenseman Kenny Morrow joined the team. 10 days later, Torrey traded Billy Harris and Dave Lewis to the Los Angeles Kings for veteran center Butch Gorey. The team did not lose once in its final 12 games.
I think the biggest thing that we ever got to come to our hockey team was Butchie Gorey. He helped with our penalty killing on our power play, and he was just probably the best guy we had in our hockey team to get guys together and keep the morale up.
There's a lot of pressure on the young kids. We wanted to relieve some of that pressure. And the reason we got Butchie was to relieve some of the pressure on Brian Trottier and some of our other kids. Butchie been through the wars, is a great little player. And he is the type of player that pressure, he was better under pressure. In pressure games, this is when he was at his best. Nothing bothered Butchie. Anything could go on around him. If he was on the ice, he was cool. And this transmitted to the younger players on our club, and it really helped a lot. And when things really got a little tough during the playoff games and things like that, Butchie was right there to settle everybody down. And in the dressing room, when everybody's uptight, Butchie'd tell a joke and loosen everybody up. And he was a big, big part in our winning.
The Islanders opened the 1980 playoffs against the Kings and immediately found themselves in a hole after winning the opener 8-1 at the Coliseum. The Kings took Game 2, and the action moved out to L.A. for Game 3. After three periods, the game stood tied and went into overtime. Then, at 6:55 of that first overtime period, defenseman Kenny Morrow scored the winner. The next night, the renewed Islanders shut out the Kings to take the series. Boston was their next playoff adversary, and this series was one that proved the club was on the trail of the Stanley Cup. The big bad Bruins were aching to drive the Islanders off the ice, but the Islanders prevailed in five games. It was the series in which the club gelled.
When we got up against the Bruins in 1980, that was a pretty tough series. They had an aggressive hockey team, and at that particular time, when Clarkey stood up to Terry O'Reilly a couple times and did really well, it showed us that, hey, we're ready to take on anybody. And Clarkey's standing up to their team, more or less, and Bobby Nystrom coming out and being very aggressive. Those two guys, I think, really showed the team that, hey, we got the team that is not going to back down from anybody.
I think it proved to our team and to other teams that our club could play any type of hockey that was demanded under the circumstances and at that time. And the Boston series was probably the most physical series I've ever seen. And our our club really responded very well. This is the type of game they wanted to play, and we accommodated them. We had Clark Gillies that kind of took a little bit of starch out of them, and along with, you know, Bobby Nice and some of our other players, and we proved to ourselves right there that each and every player was going to stand, you know, for every other player on our team. And that was a very, very tough series, but I think that gave our club the confidence to keep on going.
The next challenge would come from the spirited Buffalo Sabres, led by Gilbert Perreault and coach Scotty Bowman, mastermind of five Stanley Cups with the Montreal Canadiens. The Islanders took a two-game lead, including a victory in the longest playoff game in the team's history, won by Bill Smith's goaltending and Bob Nystrom's overtime goal.
Nystrom centering it. Here's a chance for Lorimer. Rebound, they score! Nystrom was right on top of it. You know it. You saw it. And here come the New York Islanders.
The sixth game of the Buffalo series climaxed with the Islanders winning 5-2. And for the first time ever, the New York Islanders were in the Stanley Cup Finals. But their final round would be formidable. The two-time Stanley Cup champion Philadelphia Flyers had set a regular season unbeaten record. Less than 11 minutes into the first period of Game 1 at the Spectrum, Denny Potvin accidentally scored the Flyers' first goal when he pushed the puck past Smitty in an attempt to freeze it. But Mike Bossy retaliated less than 2 minutes later to tie. Then the Flyers hit the mark late in the third period to take a 3-2 lead. The Flyer lead didn't stand up as defenseman Stefan Persson tied the game and sent it into overtime. It was only fitting that team captain Denny Potvin scored the winning goal as the Islanders took the first game 4-3. It would be a tough series, and each time the Islanders thought they had finished the Flyers, they'd come fighting back. The Islanders had a 3-2 lead going into Game 6 and held a 4-2 lead at the start of the third period of this game. But the Flyers tied it, sending it to overtime.
Well, the atmosphere going out into overtime against Philadelphia Flyers that sixth game, there was a kind of a pressure moment. I think all the guys were really concentrating on what they had to do out there. It wasn't a lot of rah-rah going on in the dressing room, but you could really see that there was concentration, intensity. Nobody wanted to be the guy that let the team down. Everybody wanted to go out there and make sure that they at least did their job, no less. And if they could come up with a big goal, that was going to be a bonus.
When the teams returned to the ice, the Flyers totally dominated the Islanders. Then, just after the 7-minute mark,
thing about that was that originally Johnson Elliott and myself had been playing with Wayne Merrick, and he had gotten a Charlie horse, so Lauren Henning had been playing in between us, and he intercepted the pass originally, and he started turning up ice, and he saw Johnny Tonelli going down the wing. He moved it up to Johnny Tonelli, and Johnny and I were going in on a 2-on-2. And for quite a while before that, we had been practicing a 2-on-2 where we crisscrossed, and Johnny would have the puck, and he would try to draw both of the defensemen with him, and then I would be left wide open. And when we executed it that day, it worked perfect because Bob Daly and Moose DuPont were playing together, and Bob Daly started going with him, and so did Moose DuPont. So Johnny just kept going, and then he stopped, made a short pass over to me, and I just had to really deflect it in. But Johnny really did make the play. He took both the defensemen with him, and it left me wide open, and I just broke for the net, and I deflected it in on my backhand.
The New York Islanders were Stanley Cup champions, and bedlam reigned at the Nassau Coliseum long after the red light flashed.
For me, it was a very emotional time because I had been thinking about this all my life, and if there was one single goal that meant more to me than anything else was winning the first Stanley Cup, and as is to most other hockey players, that's what you aim for. a great, great sense of relief that it was over and that it was in our pocket was great.
It's something that's really hard to express in words, and it was just a feeling of pride and for the players, for the organization, myself, for the fans, for everybody, because we had a tough road all those years, and but it was a great relief, let me tell you, and it's certainly something that it's hard to explain, but something you'll never forget.
Was this Islander triumph a fluke? Would the team succumb to a sophomore slump? From the start of the 1980-81 season, the Islanders dominated the NHL, and Mike Bossy scored goals by the bucketful. Only one player in NHL history had ever scored 50 goals in 50 games, the great Rocket Richard. But after 47 games, Bossy had 48 goals. Then he went scoreless for two games. He played his 50th game against the Quebec Nordiques at the Nassau Coliseum. It was tied 4-4 at the 10-minute mark of the third period, and Bossy still had not scored. But with 4 minutes and 10 seconds remaining in the game, Bossy scored number 49. He now had less than 4 minutes to score his 50th.
When Mike was going for 50 and 50, we were looking for him constantly to give him the puck. Not so much that we were avoiding our system at all, but to the point where he was in the open, he was hungry, he wanted that puck, and the opportunity came, he was wide open. I slid the puck cross ice to him, and he let it go on the fly, and it went 5-hole, and there wasn't anybody more prouder than me about Mike, and he did finally achieve it.
When I was going for the 50 goals, I think I put more pressure on myself than I really should have when I think back about it. No one really had mentioned the 50 and 50 fact until I did, and I really came out and said that I was going to do it. So I think that that's when everyone started writing about it, and I really started to put a lot of pressure on myself from that point on. When I think back and realize the importance of it to me and the dramatic fashion in which it happened, I really wouldn't change anything right now.
As the Islanders steamrolled through the season, Bill Torrey still performed refinements to the team. He shocked everyone when he traded popular goalie Glenn Resch to the Colorado Rockies for defenseman Mike McEwen and goalie Yari Karela. The Islanders, however, finished with a flourish and began the postseason by shellacking the Toronto Maple Leafs in three straight. They then disposed of the rising Edmonton Oilers in six, beat the rival Rangers in four, and the only club left between the Islanders and a second Stanley Cup was the Minnesota North Stars. It took the Islanders five games, but Wayne Merrick, who had missed the 1980 playoffs with an injury, tallied the winner in game five, and the New York Islanders made it two cups in a row. Bill Torrey knew to keep winning meant constant change, and was thinking several years ahead. He traded veteran defenseman Bob Lorimer and Dave Cameron for the Colorado Rockies' first draft choice, who turned out to be Pat LaFontaine. But his immediate aim was to bring a third Stanley Cup to the island in 1981-82. To help accomplish this, Torrey elevated 19-year-old center Brent Sutter from the juniors. Meanwhile, the Islanders were rolling along and were in sight of an NHL record, 15 wins in a row. To accomplish this, they would have to beat their former teammate Glenn Resch and the Colorado Rockies at the Coliseum. Resch was brilliant in goal that night, keeping the hapless Rockies in the game. But with less than a minute left, John Tonelli tallied the winner.
Over the line, gave it to Tonelli, shooting, he scores! John Tonelli, 47 seconds left, Islanders 3, Rockies 2!
Now it was time to make a run for Stanley Cup 3, and the Islanders' initial foe was the Penguins, who seemed an easy mark. They romped over the Pens in games 1 and 2, but a feisty Pittsburgh club bounced back to take the next two games and forced the Islanders into overtime in game 5. It was hard-working John Tonelli who finally iced the Pens. The next obstacle would be the Islanders' arch rival, the New York Rangers, now coached by Herb Brooks. But the Islanders prevailed in six games, and Ranger coach Brooks predicted the Islanders would sweep their next opponent, the Quebec Nordiques. Brooks was right, and the Nordiques fell in four. The Islanders now faced the Vancouver Canucks. The Canucks were tough, but the powerful Islanders took them in four straight and came away with their third consecutive Stanley Cup. And sharpshooter Michael Bossy was the MVP of the playoffs. For a fourth cup in 82-83 would be an arduous one. For a change, the Islanders did not dominate during the regular season. Hanging in the Islander locker room at the start of the 83 playoffs was a picture of Toe Blake, who had coached the Montreal Canadiens to four straight cups in the 1950s. On the picture, Bill Torrey had written, "History is yours for the making. Let's put Radar in this picture." Radar being Al Arbour's nickname. It was long and grueling, but the Islanders made it four in a row, the final act being Ken Morrow shooting the puck into Edmonton's empty net at the end of Game 4.
Morrow gets a stick on it. Kenny Morrow carries it over center ice, shoots into an empty net, he scores! Kenny Morrow!
The fourth cup in a row now belonged on Long Island. The club had proved itself to any and all detractors. They had become a dynasty. They were the champions.
And everything that goes with it, I thank you all. But it's been no bed of roses, no pleasure cruise. I consider it a challenge before the whole human race, and I ain't gonna lose.
We are the
champions.
Yeah!
1983-84, there was a possibility the Islanders could tie the Montreal Canadiens' record of 5 straight Stanley Cups. The Canadiens, however, only had to play 2 series to win each cup, whereas the Islanders had to play 4 series and 20 or more games to bring home Lord Stanley's cup. The 1983-84 Islanders were an aging team. There were players who had been with the team a number of years, and it just got harder and harder with each passing season. The Islanders had been accused of slacking off during the regular season the year before, so they tackled the 1983-84 season as though pursued by demons and raced to the top of the standings, finishing first of the Patrick Division. The playoffs started with a 5-game victory over the Rangers, followed by another 5-game triumph over Washington, and it took 6 games to dispose of the Canadiens. The team tired. It was hard work every time, but the club didn't dominate as it did in years past. The finals were against the Edmonton Oilers, a club full of talent, youth, and in possession of a young man named Wayne Gretzky. And the Islanders' dream of 5 straight cups came to an end as the young Oilers took the series 4-1 and brought the Stanley Cup home to Edmonton.
Mr. Gretzky has the Stanley Cup. A lot of boyhood dreams realized.
I was as proud of my players after losing that fifth, going for the fifth cup, as I was in any other of the ones we won. Because we had so many things happen to us right from the beginning, even before the playoffs started, through injuries and sickness, and we were lucky to be there. But our players just gave it everything they had, and we got there, and we gave them a good tussle for a while, except we had a bad break go against us, and we were downhill after that. But I was as proud of my players then as I was when they won the cup.
Bill Torrey and Al Arbour were now faced with a task which was, in some ways, harder than winning 4 Stanley Cups. They would be dismantling a dynasty as compassionately and gracefully as possible, while rebuilding at the same time. There were, however, few changes during the 1984-85 regular season. Torrey was not a man to act hastily. The Islanders finished 3rd in the Patrick Division that season, but there were still magnificent flashes of the Islanders' glory days. In their first playoff round against the Capitals, the club lost the first 2 games, only to sweep the next 3 and take the series. But in the second round, the team's old nemesis, the Philadelphia Flyers, defeated the Islanders in 5 games. At this point, Coach Al Arbour thought long and hard about giving up his duties behind the bench, but chose to coach another season. Bill Torrey really began the dismantling process as the 1985-86 season began, putting longtime Islander Dave Langevin on waivers, trading away Stefan Persson, and finally, he dealt popular John Tinelli to the Calgary Flames. Although the Islanders again made the playoffs in 1985-86, they were, for the first time, eliminated in 3 straight by the Washington Capitals. And it was at this time that Al Arbour, after 13 years behind the Islander bench, decided to retire.
Coaching is a very thankless job, and I've been doing it for quite a number of years. And really, the enjoyment wasn't really completely there. You really have to enjoy it 100%, 150%. You have to enjoy it because you're working 7 days a week. Hours don't really matter. It's steady, and I wasn't really getting that enjoyment out of it and really enjoying the way I should be enjoying it. And I was getting tired of the grind, the daily routine. It's basically the same all the time, and every day there's new crisis and new problems, and then my world seemed to be narrowing. Everything was just concentrated on this, and I was losing sight of everything else that was going around. And I decided at that time, I said, it's time for me to step aside and have a better look at what else is going on in the world.
Change was in the air on Long Island, from the players to the huge vacuum left by Al Arbour. His replacement was Terry Simpson. A coaching legend in Prince Albert, Saskatchewan, Simpson was Bill Torrey's choice to take over the reins from Arbour. And in 1987, the process of rebuilding the New York Islanders continued.
Lafley couldn't find Lafontaine, then he did. Pat moves in, shoots, he scores! Lafontaine!
The Islanders have a tremendous tradition all across. I mean, out west, where I came from, the Islander name is very big, you know, and I think that maybe a lot of times the actual players don't realize the tradition that they've built up. But I think for the players that are coming into the system, I think they feel that they have a reputation to live up to, and I think that's good because you don't want just the ordinary player coming in here. You want a player that's coming in that's willing to shoulder that responsibility and carry it onward. And sometimes it creates some problems because every time you go out and play, you know you're going to run into a tough game. You're not going to get any easy nights. The other teams are, if they don't remember you for the team you are right now, they remember you for the team that you were 4 or 5 years ago. And so there's the responsibilities of those things to carry on. And so I think there is a little bit of pressure on the new kids coming in, but I think that's good.
As with all teams that have built a dynasty, the tradition of winning helps mold the young and inexperienced. And like all teams that have triumphed over adversity, the traditions of diligence, perseverance, and hard work help both player and fan alike wait for the next dynasty that will become the pride of the island.
What we have done is set a standard, hopefully, for the organization. We've set a standard for ourselves in the league as an organization and a team that conducts its way in a certain way. And that's with a little style, certainly with a lot of integrity. And we play the game in a heads-up kind of manner and in a very proud way. And I hope that the players that come up recognize that and can keep up that standard because it was hard to set it.
A lot of these kids come into training camp. They're all so proud to be Islanders. The draft, some of them are, don't have the chance, really, the ability to play in the National Hockey League, but they're so proud of the fact that they were drafted by the Islanders. And you can see the tradition right there for the fact that all the players we had that built that tradition, the Stanley Cups and the character players that we had, we have a good tradition, and the players that are coming here are all anxious to wear that Islander uniform.
They say winning isn't the only thing. In a way, it is everything. I think also, though, it adds a little bit of pressure to them. Coming in and playing when you are expected to win, and when you have that legacy to carry, I think it makes it a little bit tougher for some of them. But by the same token, the example is there, and I think there is a sense of inner pride in being able to play for an organization like this.
Can't be just happy to make the team here. You've got to want to win, and you've got to have a burning desire to win, and you've got to be very disappointed to lose. You know, I think that you've got to realize that it is an accomplishment to make an NHL team. There's no question about that. And you know, the Islanders have had some success in the past, and maybe it's a little bit extra special to make the New York Islanders. But the point we want to get across is that you should be proud and happy to play as a New York Islander, but you've got to also go out there with a tremendous desire to win, and that's basically what it comes to, is that the name on the front of the jersey is more important than the name on the back.